If you think you have a crazy story, think again. Because what I'm about to tell you is definitely the craziest story I've ever heard.
It's about a guy who had a creepy obsession with little kids to the point where he ended up executing, butchering, and cooking them into meals.
But he didn't stop there. This dude would host cookouts coincidentally around the time his victims disappeared, where he would feed mysterious tasting meat to his friends and family. Shall we dig in?
Nathaniel Bar-Jonah grew up in the town of Worcester, Massachusetts. He was born in 1957 with the name David Paul Brown, but later changed his name.
Which automatically makes me think he's a criminal if he's changing names.
Well, Nathaniel was known for being quite an oddball as a kid. He apparently liked picking and sucking on his scabs, which his mom got multiple calls about from teachers at his school.
And when Nathaniel was 7, he told his neighbor, who was a 5-year-old little girl, that he just got a Ouija board and wanted to test it out with her in the basement.
Oh no, not the basement. What parent would give their 7-year-old kid a Ouija board?
Like, it's a board game that was literally invented to summon demonic spirits. No thanks.
Well, when his little girl neighbor got down to the basement, Nathaniel tried to strangle her. His mom heard the little girl screaming and ran downstairs to rescue her.
His mom assumed her son wasn't really aware of what he was doing and brushed it off.
And it turns out that Nathaniel must have known what he was doing because he kept doing stuff like that over and over again.
Over the course of his teenage years, Nathaniel lured a 6-year-old boy out to a hill to go sledding and physically violated him when he got there.
Pretended to be a cop to get an 8-year-old boy in his car, where he then assaulted and choked him,
and acted like he was a cop again, where he drove to Connecticut, kidnapped a little girl, attacked her, and threw her out of the car.
But Nathaniel only had to serve a few months of probation for these crimes.
There are so many things wrong with all of this.
And Nathaniel ended up getting released from parole early and was even sent a letter thanking him for his cooperation.
They are thanking him for kidnapping and assaulting little kids? In what world is that okay?
When he was 20, Nathaniel pretended to be an FBI agent, falsely arrested 2 boys in a movie theater, and took them to a remote location where he physically violated them.
Then, he left one of the boys in the trunk of his car, smothered the other boy with his 375 pounds worth of body weight, and drove off with the first boy still in his trunk.
Nathaniel thought the kid he left lying limp on the ground had bit the dust, but he was still alive and ended up running to get help and reported Nathaniel to the police.
The police were able to track down Nathaniel and rescue the other boy from the trunk. Officials then arrested and charged Nathaniel for attempting to slay the 2 boys, and he was sentenced to serve in jail for 18 to 22 years.
That is seriously so sick.
Also, why is Nathaniel so obsessed with pretending to be a cop to snatch up kids? Like, does he just have a cop costume handy in the trunk of his car for when he feels kidnappy?
After Nathaniel went to jail for his whole movie theater stunt, he was transferred to a mental facility. There, he changed his name from David Paul Brown to Nathaniel Benjamin Levi Bar-Jonah.
Okay, that has to be one of the longest names I've ever heard.
Well, Nathaniel was apparently Jewish, and he told his friends and family that he changed his name because he wanted to know what it was like to be discriminated against as a Jew. So when Nathaniel was serving his time at this facility, he told a psychiatrist that he had fantasies about executing people, cutting them up, and eating them.
Eating people.
So in 1991, 14 years into his sentence that was supposed to be 18 to 22 years, Nathaniel was released.
The judge apparently didn't think a man who tried to smother multiple little kids and admitted to fantasizing about eating them was crazy enough to stay in prison. So he agreed to release the creep on probation and recommended for Nathaniel to seek psychiatric help.
Recommended? That should be required for this dude.
About a month after being released, Nathaniel was back on his same old creepy shit. He saw a little boy sitting alone in a car at a post office and decided to break into the car and smother the little boy with his body, which at the time, Nathaniel weighed 275 pounds.
The mom literally saw it happen and had to run and save her kid. Then Nathaniel ran away, but was eventually caught by the cops. And one of the officers said he recognized Nathaniel from when he was arrested 15 years earlier.
So Nathaniel told the police that he broke into the car to escape the rain, but later admitted to trying to knock the boy out.
For this arrest, Nathaniel was sentenced to 2 years on probation under the condition that he moved to Montana to live with his mom and never come back to Massachusetts.
Okay, so do they think Nathaniel is gonna stop if he moves to a different state? I think they're just sending this guy to another place for their police to deal with.
So when Nathaniel moved to Montana, he reportedly started collecting a bunch of toys, which at first seems pretty normal. Nathaniel was collecting these toys and apparently having yard sales to give them away, which seems so weird to me. Like, why buy something if you're gonna immediately turn around and sell it?
Well, most people think Nathaniel had these yard sales just to lure in crowds of kids.
In 1993, just about 2 years after Nathaniel moved to Montana, he was accused of assaulting an 8-year-old boy that he was babysitting. Nathaniel denied that claim, telling officials that if he really wanted to send the boy to his grave, he would have done it.
Okay, what parent in their right mind would leave their kid with this dude?
While we never really find out the truth about this instance, and Nathaniel was never convicted because his lawyer claimed his right to a speedy trial was violated and the case was dropped.
I don't understand how they can just drop a case like that. Don't they want this awful criminal off the streets?
Well, here's where things get terrible. In 1996, a 10-year-old boy named Zach Ramsey went missing. He reportedly left for school that morning, but never made it there, so someone must have snatched him up.
And I'm just gonna go out there and say I think I know who did it.
Zach's parents filed a missing persons report, and an investigation began.
Witnesses said they saw an off-white car almost run over Zach that morning. They also mentioned the boy was crying and looked like he was being followed by an overweight man in a navy blue police-like jacket.
The detective who was on Nathaniel's previous case thought it was him again. Yeah, no shit. So officials tried to find something that would pin him to the crime.
The detective was unable to get a search warrant, but he did find out that Nathaniel had access to his mom's off-white Toyota Corolla.
He also discovered that Nathaniel had the day off Zach went missing, was seen in an alleyway right before Zach walked by, was supposedly wearing a navy blue jacket that morning, and mentioned Zach's name to someone he knew a few days before the little boy disappeared.
Okay, so this is either a series of crazy coincidences or Nathaniel kidnapped Zach. And I'm leaning more towards the second one.
Well, even though the detective was able to gather all this information, he was still unable to get a search warrant and the case went cold for a few years.
Nathaniel moved out of his mom's house shortly after Zach's disappearance.
Flash forward to 1999, Nathaniel was seen standing outside of a school wearing a navy blue jacket and hat with a fake badge. He also had a toy Glock and 2 cans of pepper spray on him.
He was arrested and charged for impersonating an officer and carrying a concealed weapon.
Wait, they're able to arrest him for pretending to be a cop, but they can't arrest him for kidnapping a little boy? How does that work?
Anyway, with this arrest, detectives were able to get a search warrant so they could search through his apartment and his mom's house, which he used to live in.
Here's what they found. 2 dark blue jackets, one which had a fake police badge on the pocket, another fake badge, a stun weapon, a baseball hat that said security enforcement,
2 documents about tying people up and smothering them, and a pulley on Nathaniel's kitchen ceiling.
Then detectives got another search warrant to search for more documents and photos, and that's when things got really bad.
Officials found several lists with boys' names on them, including 3 of the boys he had previously abused.
But wait until you hear what one of the boys' names was.
Zachary Ramsey, AKA the little boy who went missing.
And next to Zachary's name, Nathaniel wrote the word died.
Stop, this is so bad. And it makes me wonder what the significance of all the other names on the list are. Actually, never mind. I don't want to think about that.
So investigators continued their search and found at least 3,500 pictures of kids, a bunch of newspaper clippings about Zach's disappearance,
undeveloped film, which ended up being inappropriate pictures of Nathaniel and 3 unidentified little boys,
and a book written in code that turned out to be a cookbook with recipes like little boy stew and barbecued kid.
Ugh.
In Nathaniel's garage, investigators found a big section of wood that was stained and covered in marks from a weapon that looked like it was a meat cleaver.
The wood was apparently scrubbed with bleach a bunch of times too. So officials believe that Nathaniel used this area as a cutting board.
The investigators then did a luminol test in the garage and found out that the word Tita was once written on the floor, which they later theorized was connected to the execution of a 15-year-old boy named James Tita.
They also found out what appeared to be human hair inside Nathaniel's meat grinder, which was later tested and determined to belong to an unknown male.
And last but not least, investigators literally found little boy bone fragments that were never identified.
Ugh, this is so much worse than I thought.
So based on everything they found, detectives theorized that Nathaniel had butchered little kids and used them in recipes.
A few days after Zach's disappearance, Nathaniel apparently hosted a cookout where he served deer burgers that his friends and family said tasted a little off.
Nathaniel told him that he hunted the deer himself, but he didn't even have a hunting license or a rifle.
And Nathaniel had a lot of these shindigs where he would just cook for people and they always said the meat tasted weird.
It's one thing to have your own nasty criminal fetish, but don't bring other people into it without them knowing about it.
At this point, it was pretty obvious that Nathaniel was responsible for Zach's disappearance. Aside from having no alibi, matching the description of the perp, and owning pictures and newspaper cutouts of the boy, Nathaniel also had a few other things that tied him to the case.
One of his old roommates said he remembered seeing a pair of gloves covered in liquid at their apartment, as well as some clothes that looked just like what Zach was wearing when he went missing.
Nathaniel had also brought up Zach's name to his friends and roommates multiple times before and after the incident.
But get this, Zach's mother refused to believe Nathaniel did this to her son. She didn't even think her son was 86th. She'd apparently gone to a psychic who told her that her son was living in Italy.
And she was so set on this theory that she threatened to defend Nathaniel if he was brought to trial for mowing down her son.
Why would this woman not want justice for her son who was clearly made into a burger?
Well, the charges relating to Zach's disappearance got dropped, so detectives shifted their focus to three of his other victims who they knew they could pin down.
Two of the boys from the list of names lived in Nathaniel's building and were identified in some of the pictures found at his apartment.
One of them said Nathaniel invited him over for a sleepover and then violated him.
But the other said Nathaniel was his friend and even visited him in jail and gave him a letter that said, "You treated me really nice. You have never harmed me in any way. I really miss you, big guy. You were like the dad I never had."
And then there was a third boy who was supposedly hung from the pulley on Nathaniel's kitchen ceiling. Okay, can we please get this guy convicted already? I can't handle this anymore.
Finally, Nathaniel got a sentence that was better than his previous skimpy parole one. He was sentenced to 130 years in prison without the possibility of parole.
But 6 years later, Nathaniel had a heart attack from his super high cholesterol and passed away.
Yeah, if you eat a bunch of humans, you're bound to have high cholesterol, dude.
Okay, so after hearing this story, I feel like I need to take 10 showers and drink a bunch of green juices or something.
And I am so shook about Zach's mom thinking her 10-year-old son somehow made it over to Italy without her knowing, when all the signs were obviously pointing to Nathaniel cooking him into one of his disturbing recipes.
Like, did the little boy even have a passport or anything?
Anyway, I'm gonna take this as a lesson to only eat food that I've made myself, like this eggplant parmesan. Except I kind of lost my appetite, so I think I might need to wait a bit to eat it.